presentation for today. So Max is going to talk and play on top of that.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Max. First of all, thank you very much for today. I was actually surprised that all of you kind of the subjects we dealt with, it kind of had to do with my everyday life as a musician. I thought it probably would have been more theoretical and not useful for me, but you are actually. Don't worry. Yes, you're walking the right path. Don't worry at all. Well, first a little bit about my background. I'm a cello player. I studied at school at the academy. I come from a non-musical family. I, for some reason, wanted to play an instrument, and at that time in Finland, we had a very good music school system, so every kid could learn an instrument if they wanted to do so. So I learned the cello. I guess it was not enough for me, because I started playing heavy metal on cello. Why? Because I loved the music. And for some reason, I was not the only one who wanted to do so. So I had some friends, like-minded. And I was studying at the academy, and they didn't have jam classes, or we didn't even really learn chords in a way that we could use them for our own purposes. It was just analysis. So what we did was in the late night, the late nights, we played music together by Shostakovich symphonies right out of the score, just with two or three cellos. Because we knew that there is something what talks to us, but that was the only way to get really close to it. And then we started playing Metallica. I guess everybody's kind of familiar with the band Apocalyptica. We started that in around 93 or so, and released the first album in 96, and then I was there for the first three albums until the end of 2001. And that was lit, because they were idiots and I was the good guy. No, but you know how it goes. Just for the sake of it, because I sometimes, occasionally, I see this clip on YouTube, and I really love it. And I think it tells a lot about probably the era, maybe about us as a band. I think there's actually a lot to analyze. Probably for musical analysis, but for something else.
How many
cellos
was it? 12 cellos?
It was four.
Only four?
This is from 2000, from Munich.
Thank you.
Well, especially the cellists, of course. I mean, I guess we were not the only ones who did something like that, but it was a good era for wild ideas. And yeah, it happened. Because of that, I dropped out from the school and wanted to find my own path, what to do in music, and I'm still alive.
Yeah.
Nowadays, I compose a little bit. I've released 2 solo albums. Those are kind of electronic cello music. I use cello just as a, I call it a tone generator. It's not really a, it's a tool, but it's just a source for some sounds. And I then manipulate in many different ways and make music. Often I think myself as kind of as a sound scientist. I just start in something and it takes me somewhere and maybe I find the right moods, right sounds that kind of work with the vision I have and then the end result is called music. What is the material for you to work with? I was invited to New Directions Cello Festival. That was held in Ithaca, New York, upstate New York. This was already the 21st annual festival of such kind. That's why I chose the title New Directions Cello. It actually tells also a lot about me. Well, cello is there, then new. That's very important in music, because it's art. And we need to create new. That's just the fact number one. And directions, well, can go anywhere we want to. I give you a small brief about New Directions Cello Association. As I told, it's already existed for 2 decades and more. It's a non-profit organization that has created a network for the growing field of alternative and non-classical cello. The goals are to encourage interaction among non-classical cellists and to promote awareness among all cellists and the musically oriented public about the contributions that cellists are making in many styles of contemporary music. This encompasses those musical styles which are not commonly taught to cellists at music schools: jazz, blues, rock, folk, experimental, so on. Especially those involved in improvisation. Current director is cellist Chris White, and the board of artistic advisors include names like Yo-Yo Ma, Julian Lloyd Webber, and so on and so on. So it's highly acknowledged. The festival, as I said, it's an annual happening. It was always touring around States, but now for the last 8 years it's been in Ithaca. Has anybody been in Ithaca, by the way? Mm-hmm. Yes. Where Cornell University is. It's good. Very beautiful place. Mm. It's kind of, I think the whole city is kind of run by old hippies, and it's a nice vibe there. As I said, it's an annual symposium of alternative cello, performance and educational forum for non-classical cello. With performances, workshops, jam sessions, with guest artists. And this year I was one of the guest artists. The other, to mention some, there was a jazz cellist from LA called Jacob Cecchelli, who has put a great effort in teaching jazz chords to cello players. He dialed out this completely new fingering system for jazz chords for cello. And so I think it's now all online and accessible to everybody. It's only a tool, but it's a very, very important change. Because of course
throughout the years there's been individual musicians who do something crazy, but it's usually without any really tools. You just have to figure out yourself everything. But now, even in the cello world, somebody is figuring out how to do it, at least giving you the tools. And the other one to mention, there was the Celtic cellist Natalie Haas, who performed with Alastair Fraser, a very famous fiddler. And she does a lot of chopping. That's kind of a new technique for cello. You move your, I don't do it, but I can show you about chopping. It's you do sounds like this, like. Very, very good at that. So, again, one very new tool, chopping. I don't know if any contemporary composer has used it yet in a work. Maybe Esau can, maybe you can write something for a cello, do some chopping. I'd love to see a symphony orchestra doing chopping, you know, everybody together. That is the future, it will be like that, of course. These are the things that the kids come up with, and that's what we have now. That's what they want to experience, and especially if they are the ones who create it, because they are alive, at least for some time. There was some other guest artists too. I had two workshops there. And the other one about my own approach to music making and about my one-man band cello concept, where I do everything on cello and how I work with effects and stuff. Yeah. And also the challenges of a kind of a modern day freelance musician, because it's not. When they presented the boxes from the new school system, and for you it was hard to understand the differences between artist and instrumentalist and music maker. But that's true that, for example, I do all that, a little bit of all that, every day, kind of. But those are really different roles. And sometimes it's really hard for me to remember that in which box am I working right now. And I think it's, as a musician, I think that what you have there is enormous. That's a revolution. It really is. It's a big thing. And I could imagine that for the kids, they can, especially when you can always change and have a little bit. Try out and then see what is your field where you want to continue. It's really cool. When I studied cello playing, that was in the 90s. We all know how it was at schools at that point. You learn the songs, you learn the technique, and that's it. That's the purpose of it, to learn the skills. To play in an orchestra. The purpose of it, in my opinion, is supposed to be to help the student to learn what is your skill, how to become an artist. Or is there? Do they even want to become an artist? My sense. And the other workshop I had about cello rock and cello in the rock setting and challenges and in that. Many asked the same question about, well, what did you do when people ask you to play in a band or play in a song? I analyze the song. That's how I start. I listen to it and then I see the structures and kind of make a map. And like, where is the most activity in the song? And is there some spot where I can fill in, or Sometimes I say, sorry, I don't think that there's room for cello. I think you want something, but I cannot. It's not for the song, but I try to do something. Yeah. That's how I use analysis. And for me, that first listening is the most important, because then I crash. Then after that, you become familiar with the song, and you already know to remember that, okay, the first time I listened at that particular point of the song, I was drinking coffee, and it was not good. So you already dialed in your own memories to the song. You're not better. That's the problem. What was really exceptional at the festival, there was around 70 or 80 participants of all ages, plus I think like 20 kids who came there every day for a couple of hours for their own little workshops, where they played around and with cellos, without cellos, singing. The participants, they played all the time. They were jamming all the time, everywhere. And it was only cello players. I've never seen anything like that before. All the breaks in the hallways, if there was one, suddenly there was two, or three, or four. And this went on until 4 or 5 a.m. Seriously, I went to bed before they finished. And not only students together, but everybody together. Like students, teachers, everybody who was there. I think most of the participants were around 20, 30, like students. But there was also some older people who started cello very late, or played when they were kids, and then stopped and then started again. And a big common thing for them is improvisation, jamming, and everybody knows like basic chord structures and what they do better than I think anybody else, any students that I've ever met, is listening to people. Because they jam, they have to listen to what others do. They also, they follow, they're always thinking ahead, they can hear when somebody stops soloing, they can hear when somebody wants to start soloing. It's amazing. And many of them are actually studying there at Ithaca College. There's the head of cello, Lizzie Zinkin, who has her class there. And nowadays, she gets students from all around the states because they know that there's something happening there. They want to learn something more, not only just the skills to play classical music. All those students, they compose themselves. Also at the festival, they have a chance. There's kind of an open mic happening, so everybody can go up there and play if they want to. Most of them, they play their own compositions. Which, I mean, you can't really judge them, can you? They want to do so, they can do it. And something good comes out of it or doesn't. At least it's coming from inside them, and they are exposed to find it out. So I would say that this, and of course it's not the only association or festival where what is focused on one instrument and its alternative size. But it will produce better musicians, and in the end, much more interesting music. Let's get back to the notes. What I wanted to say, still a little bit about the festival. As it is, I mean, yes, it's a cello festival. It's not a music festival. It is still focused in one instrument, and that's where I kind of differ from them, because And for me, it has become just a tool. I was asked that, could you do it with another instrument, with something else? Sure.
Maybe.
But it has been, it's in the point that it doesn't really matter anymore. But I'm so used to do it with that. So why to change? And of course, it also has a certain flavor, and that's what makes the difference. For example, the solo material I write, if I would do it the traditional way with synths and computer and that stuff, it probably sound like many others. But now, as it's kind of cello based, it has its own character and tone. As I said, I compose a little bit and write a little bit for films. And that's an area where you often are asked to provide some feelings, of course. And it's an area where the music is kind of in between of information and feeling, and it's not really sort of between music and noise, and it's a really great area, and I think that's wanted, because then it leaves much more space for the receiver to build their own images. Because if we put a nice melody and something there, the receiver will immediately have an image because of the melody. But now, as we work with visual images, that has to be the stronger information form, and the music is just supporting there. So that's why often some weird noise kind of things are selected there. I find it very interesting, actually. It's something that you cannot imitate, or you can try, but you can't really, at least I don't know any way how to. Is there a system? Somebody talked about it earlier, and there's really no system to mark down what's happening in between of notes and in sounds, and I guess there's been some efforts to try to do so, but I don't know if it's needed, would it help, or is that the musician who is talking there? Is it an area that we don't actually want to have any visual presentation of it? Is it better to leave like that? That's the art. I don't know. What's that? What's the time? I'm gonna pay you a little bit too, because I hope you'll be okay. When did I start?
Right.
When did I start?
Actually, you have used 27 and a half minutes now.
That's awesome, I must say. I'd like to. I have a couple of visions and dreams that I'd like to share, because I'm an artist, so I work with dreams and visions. Mr. Tarasti started this morning talking about the music between the notes and behind the notes and on top of notes and under the notes, and that's where I work. And also, I think he introduced some boxes again, and there was a producer box, there was the composer. I don't actually agree with that, because I think if we think about the absolute music, classical music, or the absolute music, at least now, I think it would be a good idea to introduce a producer to actually produce the classical songs, kind of reproduce them, because there's so much information that could be done differently. I mean, I don't mean that we need to make elevated music out of it, but still, in the same feeling that original is, but really, you go through the information, what there is, what is relevant, what is not relevant, and then what the nowadays producer does to pop songs, if they get the song, they just see what's relevant for the song, and move out of it. That would be cool, and that would be also something cool to introduce to an orchestra. Because now I think that the conductor thinks that he's the producer, but he's actually not the producer. That does a little bit, yes, but mainly it's just following something that's already been done many, many times before. So that would be my symphony orchestra 2200. So it will take a while. But at least for a test. Because there must be something great in the music because it has survived for so long. But really, it's kind of boring to do it over and over again. It doesn't make really any sense. Is it really creative art? It's performing arts, yes. And also, is playing in an orchestra, is that creative art? Everybody's very quiet. I'm so thankful there's not too many musicians here. Yeah, just some visions. Because I've been out of the classical world for so long. Yeah, I go to concerts, and that's usually when I get these visions, these ideas. I see this same theater going on there every day. It's like, okay, this music speaks to me sometimes. But I couldn't do it night after night. I tried it, but no. For me, it was just performing art. It was not creative art. Okay, I play a little bit now. That's cool, if you can take it. Maybe 5 minutes break, something. Yeah? Mm-hmm. Cool, just plug in.
Yeah.
Or?
Yeah. Okay. Fine. Good. 5 minutes.
Yes.